warnings about the coming of the Lord. This morning I want to begin to preach about a third word that begins with W, and that is the word of the Lord. And I want to talk about that. Do you know that if you type, by the way, take your Bible and turn to 1 Peter 1 if I didn't tell you. Do you know that if you type into a computer search, if you have something of that nature, if you want to take the time to look up the phrase through a concordance, if you look up the phrase, the word of the Lord, the phrase, the word of the Lord, appears 265 times in the Bible. How many of you believe that that's probably a pretty important phrase? The word of the Lord. Many times it comes in the books that deal with the prophets, and it says things like this. The word of the Lord came to Isaiah, the prophet. The word of the Lord came to Jeremiah, the prophet. The word of the Lord came to Ezekiel, the prophet. And so on and so forth. The Bible has some other things to say about the word of the Lord. And I just want to read this first chapter of 1 Peter to you. Actually, the last two verses are what I want to work with this morning. But I like this chapter. It starts like this. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the pilgrims of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father in sanctification of the Spirit, for obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ, grace to you and peace be multiplied. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to His abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, if need be, you have been grieved by serious trials, that the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found in praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ, whom having not seen you love, though now you do not see Him, yet believing, you rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Of this salvation the prophets have inquired and searched carefully, who prophesied of the grace that would come to you, searching what or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ who was in them was indicating when He testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ and of the glories that would follow. To them it was revealed that not to yourselves, but to us they were ministering the things which now have been reported to you through those who have preached the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit, sent from heaven, these things which the angels desire to look into. I just want to stop for just a second and say, to us today, we have been blessed with what angels cannot get, but they long to see. You and I have been blessed to be living in a day and time that the prophets and the forefathers would have longed to live in this time, I believe, to see the glory revealed in the second coming of Jesus Christ. We don't realize what a privilege we've been given to be alive right now in the day and time in which we're living in. Amen? Now, he goes on to say this, therefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober and rest your hope fully upon the grace that is to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, not conforming yourselves to the former lust as in your ignorance, but as He who has called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct, because it is written, be holy, for I am holy. And if you call upon the Father, who without partiality judges according to each one's work, conduct yourselves throughout the time of your stay here in fear, knowing that you were not redeemed with corruptible things like silver or gold from your aimless conduct received by tradition from your fathers, but you were redeemed with the precious blood of Christ as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. He indeed was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you, who through Him believe in God, who raised Him from the dead and gave Him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. And since you have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit in sincere love of the brethren, love one another fervently with a pure heart, having been born again, not of corruptible seed, but incorruptible, through the word of God which lives and abides forever, because all flesh is grass, and all the glory of man as the flower of the grass. The grass withers and its flower falls away, but the word of the Lord endures forever. Now this is the word which by the gospel was preached to you, but the word of the Lord endures forever. I want to preach to you for a little while this morning about the word of the Lord. First thing that I want to say is something I think it ought to be pretty obvious to all of us here this morning. God's word is important to us. Amen? Now, I'm not talking about the Bible, but I'm talking about God's word. We've made the Bible into something that it's not. Because what, and I've said this before, and a lot of people just look at me like I'm just talking gibberish, but you've got to understand, there is such a thing out there called the fisherman's Bible. There is a thing out there called the truck driver's Bible. And for every occupation that is out there, there is some sort of a book that is entitled the handyman's Bible. What we've got to understand is, what does that word mean? The word Bible, what does it mean? And what we would say that it probably means, best way to describe it would be, whatever occupation that you might be in, that Bible that you would use for that occupation would be the instruction manual for how to live that life. God's Word, in what we call the Holy Bible, God's Word is important to you and I. I'm afraid today that God's Word is losing relevance. It's losing relevance in the church. We could already say, and I think it would be truth without any doubt, that God's Word has lost relevance to the world. But if God's Word hadn't lost relevance to the church first, it would never have lost the place in the world. Did you know still yet today the Holy Bible is still the best-selling book in the entire world? Still the best-selling book. But I'm afraid that the problem is that we own it, but it doesn't own us. We have it in our homes, but it's not in our hearts. It lays on our coffee tables, and it lays on our end tables, and it's on our shelves, and in our cars, and we have it on cute little bumper stickers, and on all kinds of shirts. But folks, if the Word is not in our heart, then the Word is not in our heart. The psalmist said, "Your Word I have hid in my heart, so that I will not sin against you." He goes on to say, "Your Word is a lamp unto my feet, and a light unto my path." God's Word is important to us, because if we don't know what God is saying to us today, if we're supposed to be following Him, how can we know where we're supposed to be going? And if we're not knowing where we're supposed to be going, how can we know what we're supposed to be doing? And if we don't know what we're supposed to be doing, how can we know what we're supposed to be saying? Amen? God's Word is important today. And I'm worried that we're leaving the Word of God. I tell you, what's passing for preaching today, of the Word today, is getting kind of scary. Turn on your TV and watch some of the stuff that's coming out of so-called Christian TV. And you'll find that what's being preached to people today, and they're receiving it as word. And hey, you know, I found something out. This is a trivial fact, but guess what I found out? Do you know what the number one killer of white-tailed deer is in America? Is it hunters? Is it predators? Is it malnutrition? Or is it cars? Malnutrition. Malnutrition is killing more white-tailed deer in America than hunters or any other thing is. Now, I would say to you today that malnutrition of the Word of God is destroying the church faster than anything that the government or any other enemy could do. Malnutrition of the Word of God is much more dangerous to the church than Islam could ever be. Because I got to tell you today, if the church really knew who she was, if she really knew what she was supposed to be standing upon today, no nation of Islam could stand against the Word of God. I watched the president's former pastor, and I say, you can't sit under somebody for 20 years and they really be your former. And I watched him in his pulpit as he went through a litany of songs that were all secular songs. And I'm not saying that's so bad, but the songs that he was choosing were some of them were horribly ugly rapping songs. And they showed in the video, they clipped it every time he did it, when he started doing the rap thing. He was trying to, I guess, engage the young people. But he grabbed his crotch in the same vulgar manner that you see it done on TV and on the MTV Awards, all that kind of stuff in the videos. And they laughed and they howled while this was taking place. And I thought to myself, my God, the Word of God is not very important in that place. Amen? Because you would never find Jesus doing something so vulgar or so horrible to get His message across. As a matter of fact, that's why they hated Him, because He would not compromise the Word of His Father that was in His heart. God's Word is important to us. Job said these words about the Word of God. He said, I have esteemed Your words more important than my necessary bread. As a matter of fact, Jesus, when He was battling with the devil in the wilderness at the end of the 40-day fast, when the devil came against Him and said, listen, I know you're hungry, and if you're the Son of God, command these stones that they be turned into bread. And Jesus looked at the devil and said to the devil, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds forth from the mouth of God. The Word of the Lord is important. Amen. In the Psalms, the psalmist said this about the Word of the Lord. He says, God has exalted His Word above His name. Think about that for a minute. How many of you believe that the name of God is powerful? In the Psalms, the psalmist says, the name of the Lord is a strong tower, and the righteous can run to it for protection. And yet, he goes on to say that God exalted His Word even above His name. Now, if God's name is so powerful that the righteous can run to that strong tower and be protected in that strong tower of God's name, if God has exalted His Word even above His name, how many of you believe then that the Word of the Lord is very important to you and I today? Amen. Why would God say this, that His Word is exalted higher than His name? Because if your word is no good, it'll taint your name. Amen. There used to be a time in this country when a man's word was his bond. If you shook hands with somebody and you said, we got a deal, a handshake was as binding. And by the way, in case you've never studied business law, a handshake or a verbal contract, if you have witnesses, is just as binding today as a written contract. How many of you know, though, that we have found through sports figures and all other kind of things that contracts, even written, don't mean a whole lot today? God's Word is important to us today, and it's because we know this, is that God's Word reveals to us so much of who God is. The second thing that we understand about the Word of the Lord, and another reason why that the Word of the Lord is important to us, is that the Word of the Lord is the vehicle through which the gospel is proclaimed and received. Isaiah says in Isaiah 53, who has believed our report, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? In the book of Romans chapter 9, the writer there writes these words, how can they hear if there is not a preacher? He goes on to write later on that it is by the foolishness of preaching or proclaiming the word that the lost get saved. Folks, listen to me. The word of the Lord is the vehicle through which the gospel is proclaimed and received. I thank God today for people who are willing to preach the word. Amen? Preach the word. I'm not talking about preaching psychology today. I'm not talking about preaching from U.S. World News and Report or today's Time Magazine or anything of that nature. I'm not against quoting something from that. But I want you to know something today, that it is the Word of the Lord and it is the gospel of Jesus Christ through that Word that must be proclaimed. Amen? Paul the Apostle writes in Romans chapter 1, verse 16, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, because it is the power of God to those who believe, to the Jew first and then to the Greek also. That means you and I. Amen? They got it first. They refused it. Thank God He didn't shut the door. He left it open so that you and I could hear the gospel and be saved. So the gospel, the word of the Lord, it's the vehicle through which the gospel is proclaimed. Now, let's get to this. God's word tells us about God. If I told you, I want you to read the story of Pinocchio. Who do you think the story of Pinocchio was about? Pinocchio. Now, are there other characters in the book? Absolutely. The man who made him and all those things. But the main story is about Pinocchio. What happened? Oh no. David. Our screen went blank. God's Word tells us about God. The first blank I want to give you then is this. It tells us about His nature. His nature. What do we know about the nature of God? God is love. Amen. How many in the room are glad that He's a God of love this morning? Amen. Anybody else besides the preacher here that'd be in hell right now if God wasn't love? Amen. He is love. God is mercy. On and on and on. But one of the other things that I want you to see is also it tells us about His attributes. What are one of the things about His attributes? Right off the bat, here in 1 Peter chapter 1, as I read to you today, we saw this. God said, I am holy. Therefore, you must be holy. God is just. Now I want to ask you a question in the room. Is there anybody in the room who has never made a mistake? Sorry, buddy. You made one this morning. I saw it. You ran when they told you not to. Bless his heart. He got in a sermon 2 Sundays in a row, Mark. I've been asked to come and preach funerals, be a part of funerals that, for all intents and purposes, the end probably wasn't a very good thing. I've preached, and I got to tell you, even I don't care. I'm not going to preach anybody into heaven, but I'm certainly not going to preach anybody into hell, because I got to tell you, you should be very glad for what I'm about to say. I am no one's judge. Amen? Now, it's obvious that there are some things that don't look good. Amen? Nonetheless, as long as there's breath, there's life. And as long as there's life, there's hope. And I believe this with all of my heart, that any person who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. I've told you all the story, but one night when we were still living in the parsonage, I heard an ambulance coming. I stepped out and I saw him turn the corner and head up towards Scott and them's house. So I jumped in my car and drove up there, and just past, I pulled in the driveway there and parked there in Sharon's driveway, and I ran across the street where I saw him, and there was a boy laying in the front yard. And literally what he had done, he wrecked his car and it threw him out, and he ended up dying in his own front yard. And as I walked up, I heard one of the EMTs on the radio saying, we need the coroner. And I asked her, I said, listen, do you care? Can I go over and pray for him? She said, go ahead, sir. And I went over and got down on my hands and knees, and I got in that man's ear, and I told him the gospel, and I prayed the sinner's prayer with him. And you say, well, preacher, they were already calling for the coroner. Well, I've been told this. I don't know how they know it, but I've been told that hearing is the last thing that leaves the body. And if it's possible, someday I hope to meet that young man on heaven's shores, because I believe God is that merciful that even in that late stage of life, He would give somebody hope to make it into heaven. But I've also been there where people died horrifically. I was called to several times when people have accidentally killed themselves by taking drugs and overdosing, and their hearts quit or whatever may be the case. And people would say, well, there's no hope, preacher. You know, one young person, they found their body in a garbage dump. And here's what I say in the face of all of that. I say, listen, I'm not anybody's judge, because I make mistakes. And if I was God, like I am right now, there would be people that were supposed to get into heaven that I'd say, nope, you can't get in. And there'd be other people that weren't supposed to get in that I'd say, come on in. Folks, listen, here's the fact of the matter. When you and I get to heaven, we are going to look around and there's going to be people there that we never dreamed would make it. We're going to be shocked. Oh, Lord, I never thought you'd make it. And then we're going to look around. There's going to be people when we're going to say, where on earth are they at? I thought for sure they'd made it. If anybody would have went to heaven, I'm sure they would have. And then reality is going to set in and we're going to say, oh, dear God, thank you for letting me in. Amen. I'm just glad that I made it in. Now, here's what I know to be the truth about God. God is just. And when we fall into His hands, He will make no mistakes. Amen? How many are glad for that attribute of God? He makes no mistakes. He is just. and He is also wrathful. Let's talk about His accomplishments. His accomplishments. What do we know about God's accomplishments? Well, one of the things, and there's a whole sermon to be preached from this, the very first verse of the Bible, the very first five words, if you can accept those, you can believe everything He ever said or was said He did. It starts like this: in the beginning, God. Doesn't matter what else comes after. If you can't accept those first five words, the rest of it's a lie. But if you can believe those first five words, then you can believe the rest of the book is true and everything He said is real. Now, here's what I find to be funny today. As we go on in history, Baptist preachers, one just recently left our town, that are preaching that what's written in the book of Genesis is really just kind of like a fairy tale and a bunch of stories that were made up. None of it's really true. Well, listen to me, folks. If any of that is made up, then all of it is and none of it's true, and we need to throw it out. But if those first five words are true, then we know God has done great things. Amen? And He still will do great things. The last thing that it reveals to us is God's power. His power. Well, let's just go back again to the very first statement of the Bible. In the beginning, God created. That says a lot about His power right there. Well, how did He create? Did He take a hammer and nails and chisels? And did He have blueprints? And did He draw things up? And did He hire construction companies to come in? No. The Bible says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now check this out. It says, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep. And God said, let there be light, and there was light. Notice how God created it. God said it, and it was so. What was not, He called into existence. Now there's a bunch of New Age preachers that claim to be gospel preachers that are saying you and I have the same power. That if you want a Rolls Royce, you just need to proclaim you're a Rolls Royce. If you want a Rolex, you need to proclaim a Rolex, that you have the same creative power. But I want to say this. I do believe that we need to start speaking the truth, and we need to start telling the truth about who God is and what His power is today. And I want to say this really quickly, that if God ever healed anybody ever, then He can still heal him today. If He ever set anybody free, then He can still set them free today. If He ever did anything, Troy, He can still do it today. Amen. God's Word tells us about God. But also, God's Word tells us about Jesus. Tells us about Jesus. Now, some of this is going to be redundant for a little while. First thing we see about it is that it tells us about His nature. His nature. How many of you believe that Jesus is love? Amen. How many are glad that He is? You know, the Bible says in John 3:16 that God so loved the world. But I believe that if Jesus didn't love us, He couldn't have gone through it all for us either. Amen. How many believe that it's important in a home with a mom and daddy that both parents love the children? Amen. I know that sometimes that there are those who enter into abusive situations for the kids and for one of the spouses when one of them don't want to be in a family situation. But I got news for you, folks. Jesus and His Father agreed on us that we were worth it. And He loved us enough to do it for us. His attributes, it tells us about His attributes. And I suppose the most important attribute that I could describe for Jesus today is that He was obedient. Amen? Obedient. The Bible says that He became obedient even to the death on the cross. I want to say this. If obedience was important to Jesus, it ought to be important to you and me. As a matter of fact, in the book of Hebrews, chapter 4, it tells us that Jesus became the author of salvation to all who obey Him. That's pretty important. It tells us what He has done. Oh, hallelujah. How many feel like the Lord has ever done anything for you? Amen. But I look back into this book and I read about some of the things He has done. He walked on water. He raised the dead. He healed the sick. He opened blinded eyes. He put legs back on that were gone, arms back on that were gone. One man that had leprosy, He healed him and made him whole. And I think sometimes we don't grasp what whole means. When you deal with somebody that's been a leper or knows anything about leprosy, leprosy eats off the flesh. Hands can be gone. Fingers can be gone. Noses can be gone. Ears can be gone. Various body parts can be gone. And when Jesus made them whole, it was like they had never had leprosy in the first place. In other words, whatever was gone was back. Funeral directors hated to see him come to town because if they were walking through, he'd raise their dead. I don't know if they had to give the money back or not. On and on and on and on. We know that he went to the cross and he died on that cross for you and I. And folks, I want you to understand something today. It was not nails that held him on that cross. Amen. The Creator of all things could not be held by something he had created. What held him there was his love and his obedience to God and love for us. It tells us about his power and the power that he has still today to save to the uttermost all who call upon his name. The Word of God also tells us about the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit. What about the Holy Spirit? Well, first of all, it tells us about his nature. Remember, I said this was going to be a bit redundant. What do we know about this Holy Spirit's nature? Well, I can tell you this. Yeah, he's a gentleman. I like that. I didn't think about putting that in there. He's a gentleman. The Holy Spirit will never force you. He will never force you to do something you don't want to do. If you don't want to be saved, the Holy Spirit will never. That's why sometimes you'll hear me whenever it comes time, when I reach a certain place in the invitation, and I feel like the Spirit of God says, that's it, we stop. Because I want to tell you something. If you're not ready by the second verse, chances are you're not going to be ready by the fifth or sixth. Amen? Now, if the Spirit of God is working in great convicting power, then He'll deal as long as He wants to deal, and we'll stay till He says, get done. Amen? But He's a gentleman. He won't bust your door down. He'll knock at the door. Another thing that we see about the Holy Spirit is that He's the Spirit of truth. Maybe that's part of His attributes that I should talk about there. He's the Spirit of truth. You know what I find amazing to me? Is I find amazing to me people that claim to be filled with the Spirit of God that are caught up in all kinds of idolatry and paganistic things. And they fuss at people who are finding their pathway in the Word of God. And sometimes I just want to stand up and scream, you're supposed to be filled with the Spirit of God. Did you know that that was one of the things that Jesus said? He said that when the Spirit of truth, who was He talking about? The Holy Spirit. He said when the Spirit of truth is come, He will guide you in all truth and of things concerning Me. Now, I know that you don't like to hear this, but again, I ask the question, what do bunnies and eggs have to do with the resurrection of Jesus Christ? And I can tell you if they don't have anything to do with it, then it didn't come from the Spirit of God, which is what? Spirit of truth. And Jesus said He'll teach you about Me, about Jesus. And so if we got things mixed up in our holy traditions that aren't so holy, guess where they came from? That's just a little bit of common sense there, isn't it? The Spirit of truth. He's the Spirit of truth. I want you to know something. The Holy Spirit gets along just as well with the Father and the Son as they do with Him because they're all one and they work together in unity. This thing that's called the Trinity would never work if each one was to take off on their own path. That's why we don't need to have Holy Ghost conferences. Amen? What you want to have is a Holy Bible conference and talk about the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen? Don't work on just one, because if you try to single out the Holy Ghost, He's going to tell you, don't look to Me, look to Jesus. That's why when Benny the Hen stood up and said that the Holy Ghost told him what He told him about women giving birth through their sides, I said, that didn't come from Jesus, or that didn't come from the Holy Spirit, because it's got nothing to do with Jesus. He is the Spirit of truth. And when we're walking in error, folks, and the Lord decides to let us see the truth, we ought to thank God for it instead of refusing it and accept it because it came from the Lord. Amen? All right, I got to hurry on. God's Word tells us and it also tells us what He is doing. What He is doing. And notice what I didn't put there. I didn't put what He has done. Read the book of Acts and you can see what He has done. But the book of Acts should be, instead of chapter 28 being the end, it ought to read, and a continuation of what the church is continuing to do through the power of the Holy Spirit, because He's still working today. Remember what I said at the first? If God has ever healed, He still heals. If God has ever delivered, He's still delivering. Well, I want to say this. If anybody has ever been filled with the Spirit, then we can still be filled today. If anybody has ever been led by the Spirit, then you can still be led by the Spirit today. The Spirit of God is still alive. And don't let anybody tell you that when the last apostle died, that was the end of the Holy Ghost. You think about that for a minute. Because see, if the Spirit doesn't draw you, you can't be saved. And so if the Holy Ghost basically was done when the last apostle died, then there hasn't been anybody saved for nearly 2,000 years. How many in the room know you're saved this morning? So then we know that to be a lie, don't we? The Spirit of truth. Remember, He's the Spirit of truth. And He's alive and well on planet Earth today. And He is still filling people today with the Spirit of God and with the power of God. All right, I got the power in there at the very last. Let's go on. God's Word tells us of the history of the planet. Now, I hope that I'm not going to hurt your feelings today. But I got to tell you, evolution is not just a theory. It's also a lie. I down at Mardi Gras this year, we had some guy butted up on me, and he's like, I suppose you don't believe in evolution. I looked at him, I said, I don't know why anybody would. And he looked at me, he said, well, there's scientific proof for it. And I said, well, actually, there's not any scientific proof for it. But I said, there's one thing that it's called that ought to give you a clue to what it is and why you shouldn't believe it as truth. He said, what's that? I said, it is still called the theory of evolution. The theory of evolution. And he said, well, no, it's no longer the theory of evolution because there's scientific facts to back it up. And I said, well, sir, I don't know where you're getting your facts, but if it's just like the rest of the global warming nonsense coming from Al Gore, then you've been lied to just like he's lied to all of us. Because it's not true, because when you take the theory and you try to apply it, sooner or later, you got to have something that gave us a start. And if you have something that gave us a start, there had to be someone who made the something. You see, the entire problem with evolution is that evolution wants to do away with God. Amen? Evolution doesn't want to bow its knee and say, God, you are God, and you are the creator of us all. And so evolution came up with this. And if you've never watched the video, you've got to just kind of buckle down and hang in because it's dry as cracker juice. But I'm telling you, you need to watch the video by Ben Stein. Watch the video by Ben Stein, Expelled, No Intelligence Allowed. And on there, you'll see some of the best proponents of evolution made to be fools, because the best they can offer is that somehow or another a little cell climbed into the crack of a crystal as the crystal climbed up out of the muck and mire. All I want to know is, where did the crystal come from? And where did the muck and the mire come from? And where did the single cell came from that crawled into the crack? And so when Ben Stein asked the man, he said, well, I need you to explain to me where this all came from. And the man said, I just did. And he said, well, can you explain it to me again? And he said, well, a single cell got into the crack of the crystal and it climbed up out of the muck and the mire. And Ben was like, okay, so where did it all begin from? Where did that come from? He said, I just explained it to you. Folks, that's the best they got. That's their best and brilliant, brightest minds. Because they understand that if they say, well, it all started with a big bang, when the gases all collided and they exploded, we all know this to be the truth, is that order never develops from chaos. Never happens. There's never been an instance when anybody ever took one of those giant slingshot things, loaded up a bunch of scrap metal, slung it 5,000 feet into the air, and when it landed, it was a car. Amen? Common sense tells us that that's not truth. Common sense tells us that it cannot happen that way. Amen? And yet, we've got these proponents out there. And folks, I had a young man down there again at Mardi Gras coming to me, and he said, I'm a Christian, but... Yeah, you guys got it. I'm a Christian, but... Don't you believe in evolution? And I said, absolutely not. I believe the Bible. And he said, well, I believe the Bible too, but our preacher says that God used creation and evolution. And I looked at him and I said, just that very thing, your preacher's a liar. Because the Bible never says anything other than this. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. He didn't need evolution. He didn't need devolution. Now, I got to be honest with you. I do believe in evolution. But I believe this. I believe man started out with everything and we're evolving back toward nothing. But that has nothing to do with God. We've done that to ourselves. Amen? So God's Word tells us the history of the planet. How did it start out? By the way, if you want to know what God thinks about marriage, get in God's Word. Right in the very first book of the Bible, He institutes the plan for marriage. Adam, He created Adam on the sixth day, put him in the garden. Later on, He finds that Adam's lonely. God says, everybody say, God says. God says it's not good for a man to be alone. And so God brought all these things in front of him. And even with all those things, Adam was still lonely. And so God put Adam to sleep, took a rib out of his side and created a woman. He set her before him. He woke Adam up and she literally knocked his eyes out. Adam goes, woohoo! Where has she been? Amen. God did the first marriage there and God said these words. Later on, Jesus quotes it. And then later on, we have Paul quoting Jesus quoting it. God said in the very first book of the Bible, therefore for this reason shall a man leave his father and mother and he shall cleave to his wife and they will be one flesh. There you have it right there. Man and woman, not Adam and Eve, or not Adam and Steve, or even Abigail. Adam and Eve, man and woman, that's it. It explains it all. Well, God doesn't say anything about homosexuality. Well, right there He didn't say anything about bestiality either, did He? But how many of you believe that's wrong? You don't have to be told. He said what He said without having to say anything more. He said what He blessed, which was one man and one woman together for life. Now, if you've messed up, thank God for your ability to repent and start over and stay with what you got right now. And the church said, amen. Amen. We find the history of marriage. We find the history of the family. We find the history of sin. On and on and on throughout the Word of God. We find the history of the planet. We find God choosing a people. We find that they failed Him, and yet He stayed faithful to them. Over and over again, we find out what God has to say about this. We also find out that God's Word tells us about the right here and now. A lot of people say, well, that's an old book. Yeah, that's what some of the idiots in government right now are trying to say about our Constitution. And yet our Constitution, if it's allowed to do its job, will still work today, 200 plus years after it was written. Amen? Yes, God's Word is about a different culture than ours. But if we'll take and study that Word and apply it to our lives right now, God's Word will still work today. Check it out. Here's what it says. Here's what God's Word. By the way, how many of you just hate it when you're running down the interstate and the police pass you like you're sitting still? And then you find them sitting on the side of the road clocking other people later on. Does that not just kind of goad you just a little bit? Or you read where they want to make a guy Secretary of the Treasury and put him in charge of your taxes and you find out he hasn't paid his. Amen? Come on now. Or you find out they're going to put somebody on trial for lying to Congress when Congress stands up and lies to us all the time. Now what have I said all that for? Because here's what the Bible says. In the right here and the right now, the Bible says to those who are in charge, do what's right to the people. Don't charge more taxes than you're supposed to. Don't take from them more than what you're supposed to. Treat the people right. Lead them in the right direction. And if you'll do that, the people will follow you. That's God's Word for the right here and right now. As a matter of fact, the Ten Commandments, which were written thousands of years ago, would still work for us today if we'd let them. How many of you believe that many, many a home would be a better place if the children knew for a fact that God said, honor your father and your mother, and if kids would honor their mom and dads? Come on now. I want to tell you something. Do you want to make your preacher upset? Let little Johnny, let little Janie get away with sassing you. I'll bite my tongue for so long, but there'll come a time when I'll finally have to say or do something. Amen? I wasn't raised that way. Anybody else know what I'm talking about? I'm telling you, I wasn't raised. Kids, listen, there was an old saying, kids were meant to be seen and not heard. Amen? Now, I don't believe in hurting children, but sometimes I think some pride needs to be spanked. There's a lot of stuff that I know people that are teachers in school today that if the fifth commandment was applied in the home and kids were taught that they have to honor mom and dad. Listen, folks, your kids act out in public out of how they're allowed to act at home. Kids go to school. When I was teaching school, I knew which kids were the boss at home because of how they tried to come in and run me. But I got to tell you this. You need to raise your children to be obedient, because sooner or later they're going to run into somebody that's more stubborn than they are. Amen? Well, sooner or later they're going to run into somebody who's meaner than they are, and you're going to end up getting their lips smashed all over their face because they're going to be somebody that won't take their junk. How many believe this? How many believe that the world would be a lot better place if men and women that are married knew they better keep their hands off of somebody else's spouse? You know, thou shalt not commit adultery. Or what about this? Thou shalt not steal. How many of y'all hate to have stuff stolen from you? Amen. What about this? You shall not covet. In other words, want what you got, not what somebody else has. Now, there's nothing wrong with seeing somebody with a nice car and saying, I'd like to have one of those. That's not what the Bible's talking about. The Bible's talking about that you see what they have and you say, you know what, I'd like to have that. And then you go about doing whatever you have to do to make that yours. What about this? You shall not murder. I find it a bit hypocritical that the two so-called reverends, Al and Jesse, have been down in Florida screaming about one young black man that was, and we don't know yet the truth of what happened. And we may not, since there was only two people there and one of them didn't survive. But I want to tell you something. Anytime Al and Jesse show up, they're known liars. I have a high suspicion of anything they have to say. Amen? But what about the hypocrisy of this? It's a tragedy that that young man was killed. I'm not taking that away. But do you know this today, folks? Five, across this nation, every year for the last 10 years, 5,000 young black people have been killed in this nation. Every year, 5,000. And over 90% of those were done by other blacks. That's 4,500 blacks a year killed by each other. Over the last 10 years, folks, listen, that's not one tragic death. That's 45,000. How many believe our world would be a little bit better if we understood you shall not commit murder? By the way, we have murdered some 50 million babies since 1973. Who knows what technological advances we've dumped down our sewer systems and into our garbage dumps through the murder called abortion. How many believe our world might be a different world than it is today? God's Word tells us about the here and now. We can have it, folks. We can have it. What about this? If we jump all the way to the New Testament and we hear what Jesus says, and Jesus says there's two commandments, basically. Number one, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and your neighbor as yourself. How many believe that would rock your world today? Amen. Let me move on. God's Word tells us about the future. Oh, hallelujah. Your future holds about 10 more minutes of me if you can stand it. You okay? Can I finish up? God's Word tells us about the future. Yes, it is a futuristic book. The poor people who say they dismiss it and say, that book is all out of date and it's old-fashioned, what they don't realize. And also people go to church and say, well, we're New Testament Christians. Well, guess what, honey? Your Old Testament still has prophecies that have yet to be fulfilled. So that means it's not a dead book yet either. Amen? So do those people who think this whole book is old and outdated, it still has things yet to come. Do those people who think it's only the New Testament, I got news for you. The whole book has got things yet to come. God's Word tells us about the future. And here's what it tells us, what's going to happen on planet Earth. Let me tell you, I believe right now we're wrapping up what we know the function of planet Earth to be. Soon and very soon, there's going to be a man rise on the scene. The Bible identifies him as the Antichrist. We've said again and again, if you have not given your life to Jesus Christ, you will one day meet the Antichrist. He's coming on the scene. And what he's going to do is he's going to develop a world government. This man is suddenly going to have a plan. I believe he's already on the face of the earth right now. He's suddenly going to have a plan. He's going to solve the problem of the Middle East with Israel and the surrounding Arab nations. But in the middle of a 7-year treaty that this man is going to come up with, it's going to look brilliant. In the middle of it, at 3.5 years, the Bible says he's going to break the treaty. He's going to be exposed for who he is. The Jews are going to recognize him for who he is. They're going to realize he's not the one they thought he was. He's going to go into the house of God. He's going to commit abomination of desolation. In other words, he's going to offer a pig on the holy altar. He's going to desecrate the house. But in the midst of all of that, Satan is going to be pouring out his wrath on planet Earth. God is going to begin to pour out his wrath on planet Earth. If you're not saved, you're going to have to be here and see all of that. But if you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I got good news for you. God has not made us to obtain wrath, but rather to obtain salvation. The Lord Jesus said, when you see these things begin to take place, lift up your head because your redemption is drawing nigh. In other words, we're about to get out of here. Amen? We're about to get out of here. The Bible tells us what's going to happen in eternity, unfortunately, for the lost. My friends, I want to tell you something today. Again, I'm not being your judge. I'm simply telling you the Word of God. The Bible says it is appointed unto man once to die, and after this the judgment. You and I have an appointment. We're going to keep it unless the Lord returns first. It also said some men's sins go on before them, others follow after them. What does that mean by some men's sins go on before them? I believe every person in this room who have come to the Lord and said, Lord, forgive me, I pray. I believe your sins have been dealt with and judged right then and there, and they have been done away as if they never existed. But today, if you're not a child of God, every sin you commit is chasing you like a train about to run you down. I don't know if you've ever been near a train or not, but one time when I was about 15 years old, we lived out in the countryside just northeast of Indianapolis, a little town called Oak Landon. And actually, we lived just outside of that town, and the park was about a mile away. And the quickest way to get there was to cut down the tracks. And the tracks was a dual set of tracks there. And so I was going down the tracks and I saw a train coming. We used to see trains all the time, you know. You just jump on the other track and keep on walking. But as I was walking and as it was coming toward his train, he starts blowing his horn. And I couldn't figure out why he was blowing his horn. And then I turned and looked and there was another train coming behind me. And for a very brief period of time, I was in between the tracks, between those two trains. And folks, I want to tell you something. Trains, man, I'm telling you, when they're passed, there's a suction there you don't realize that they create. It's like when a semi passes you and kind of causes that whipping action. And literally, I was afraid that I was going to get, you know, drug underneath that train there. And here's what I want to say to you. If I made that analogy good to you at all, if you're here today and you're living without God, or if you're living in deliberate sin, their sin is following you like a freight train, and one day it's going to catch you at the judgment of God. And I want you to know today that if you refuse to put those under the blood of Jesus Christ, if you refuse to accept the Son of God as your Lord and Savior, they're going to catch you. And your sins will speak louder than any other words you can say. And they'll condemn you in that day. Here's what the Bible says. This is not what the preacher says it says. This is what the Bible says. The Bible says that every person who rejects the Son of God, there will come a day and there will come a time when they, along with the beast, the Antichrist, the false prophet and Satan himself will be cast into the lake of fire and will be forever in torment and flames and never to be set free and eternally separated from God. That's what the Bible says. But I want to tell you what the Bible says about the eternity for those who are saved. Hallelujah. How many know you're saved this morning and you're glad you know you're saved? Amen. Come on. Let's give the Lord praise right now. Aren't you glad? Aren't you glad He was merciful to you one more time and saved your never dying soul? Amen. Isn't it good to know today that your sins have been forgiven? Hallelujah. You know what? There's things about my past I hope you don't ever find out. There's things that people know about me that many of you will never find out. I hope you never do. But I'm glad beyond a shadow of a doubt, even though my past, some may want to bring it up and throw it in my face. In the place that matters most, Mark, He's never going to mention it against me ever again. Every sin I ever committed and what I asked Him to forgive, He not only forgave me, Brother Bill, but He forgot it. Hallelujah. He forgot it. I go to Him sometimes and I'm feeling guilty in my soul and I say, oh God, I want You to forgive me of my sins. And I feel like He's saying to me, I don't know what You're talking about. What sin are You asking for? You see, He doesn't hold it against us. I said, He doesn't hold it against us. I hold it against me sometimes. I sometimes beat myself up and I get mad. Why didn't I give my life to Him sooner? I could have saved myself scars. I could have saved myself misery. I could have saved myself money. Amen. Anybody in the room be better off financially if you'd have got saved sooner than you did? Amen. But I want to tell you something. All I know is this. I've never met a saved person yet who really got saved that ever regretted getting saved. The only thing you ever regret is that you didn't do it earlier. Amen. You didn't do it sooner. You didn't start living for the Lord sooner. Because I want to tell you something. Not only is it going to pay off in the future, it pays off right here in the here and now too. Amen. We could go into all that, but those of you know the truth. It's much better living for God than it is living for the devil. But check this out. Here's what the Word of God says is this. To those of us who have died, I want to tell you a quick story. I still got just about 5 minutes left of my 10. This past Wednesday, I got up in the morning and I wanted to take my dad and my mom down to see my dad's only remaining sister, my Aunt Mallie. And Daddy just wasn't able to go on Wednesday, but I felt compelled to go. And so I went ahead and drove on down. And I got down there and saw her, and she was in very bad shape, almost 91 years old, suddenly developed bone cancer. She's in the last stages of this cancer. Last time I talked to her, it was on the phone. This time I see her, she can hardly speak. They woke her up and they said, "Mom, look who's here." They said, "Do you know who this is?" And she looked up and through clenched teeth, she said, "It's Rusty." Man, I want to tell you something, that tickled my heart, you know. But we talked around and visited a little bit, and then she kind of fell back asleep a little bit, as the medicine's prone to do. And I got ready to leave, and we gathered around her bed. There were four of us there, and we gathered around the bed, and we joined hands, and we joined hands with her and began to pray for her. And when I said amen, this poor little lady whose body's racked with cancer, she took off and started praying. You ever had somebody pray after you prayed just make you feel like you wish you hadn't said nothing? Man, she started praying. It just felt like God just was like, "Everybody shut up, Mallie's talking." And she began to thank God for saving her. Thank God for her preacher and just different things. Man, I'm telling you, it was just people, we were just standing there crying, you know. But if she said it one time, I think she said it probably 5 times. She said, "Dear God, please give me the strength to live long enough to see my brother one more time." I looked at my cousin, I said, "I'll get him down here. One way or another, I'll get him down here." So I went back home. I got hold of Mom. So Thursday morning, I was supposed to meet them at 11 o'clock. And I went to the gym. I come out of the gym. My phone was lit up with missed calls. And so I called. My cousin told me, she's Rusty, the hospice nurse is here. And she says she doesn't think Mom's going to make it until you get Uncle Elmer down here. I ran home, got changed, drove to Indiana where Mom and Dad are at, got them there. We beat feet for Monticello. We got there. The whole time we were there, every time the phone would ring or the text would go off, I was expecting somebody to say she passed. We got there. She was still alive, but she was totally in a coma. Her eyes were fixed. And Daddy sat down beside her. And I'm telling you, folks, if you've got a hard heart, you just need to see what happens when somebody you love, you sit down beside him. And he began to stroke her hair and said, "Sis, I'm here. Your brother's here." You know, man, I was sitting there, but in my heart, I was thankful that I got him there before she died. But in my heart, I kept thinking, "Travis, something's not right." And I had to leave shortly. I left about 6 o'clock that night, come back home. I left them there. I called about 8 o'clock or 9 o'clock Friday morning. I said, "Mom, what's the word?" She said, "Rusty?" She said, "It's amazing. She woke up this morning, and she knows who your dad is." I said, "She's probably not going to be long." God answered her prayer. About 9 o'clock Friday night, my sister texted me. About 30 minutes after my two sisters got there, my Aunt Mallie took her last breath. And I believe she quit breathing here and started breathing there. See what happened? You say, "Preacher, did you not pray and ask God to heal her?" Yes, I did. But you know what, folks? Listen, it's appointed unto man once to die. Folks, listen, sooner or later, if the Lord tarries, we're going to die. But this is going to die, but what's inside here is not. And if you belong to the Lord, the Bible says that when this thing dies, what we call the body, we are absent from the body, we are present with the Lord. Home free, perfectly healed, amen, perfectly safe, never in danger ever again, no more sickness, no more pain, no more sorrow, and no more sin or shame. Hallelujah. And the Bible says forever. Amen. That's okay. Go ahead and praise the Lord if you want to. "And ever and forever shall we be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words." Now, my Aunt Mallie, my Mamma, my Grandpa Watson, Grandma Watson, and others have gone on to be with the Lord. Many of you in this room have loved ones who have gone on to be with the Lord. So what's going to happen? Where are they at? Their spirit, their soul is going to be with the Lord. Their body rests in the ground. If they've been buried any time long, I don't mean to be gross here, but the fact of the matter is that their body has rotted, decayed, and turned back to dirt. So what's going to happen? I'm glad you asked. 1 Thessalonians 4 says this, "For the Lord Himself shall descend from heaven with a shout. The trumpet of God shall sound, the archangel will shout, and the dead in Christ shall rise first." Here's what's going to happen. Those that have died, their bodies are going to come up out of that grave. It's going to bust open, and a new body is going to spring forth. And again, that's what the Bible calls a glorified body. No more sickness, no more pain, no more problems, and the ability to fly, because we're going to join with them, and we're going to meet the Lord in the air, and thus shall we ever be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. It tells us what's going to happen in eternity for the saved. We're ever going to be with the Lord. There's much more to it than that. The time will not allow me to tell more. Last thing I want to say is this. God's Word has never failed, and it will never fail. If God has promised you something here today, then you can still have it. Amen? I said, if God has promised you something here today, you can still have it. If God has said He will do something, He will still do it. If God has said He will provide for you, He will still provide, because He is still God. Now some people say, again, you know, some people don't like for people to quote from the Old Testament, because what we like to quote is the verse where God says, "I am the Lord, I don't change." But they say, well, that's the Old Testament, you know. Okay, well then let me give you what it says in the New Testament. Jesus Christ the same, yesterday, today, and forever. Doesn't matter how you look at it, in the Old Testament and in the New, He's still God, and His Word is still exalted above His name. It has never failed, nor will it ever fail. I want to say something to you here today. I want to take a bold step and proclaim. If you're praying for a loved one to get saved, keep praying, because God's going to do it. If you're praying for somebody to be healed, if you're praying for something to be provided, to be changed in your life, keep praying, because God's going to do it. Amen? If you're seeking God for something, if you're asking Him for power in your life, whatever it may be, keep doing it, because Jesus said, describing His Father, He said, "If you as a good father know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more so will your Heavenly Father give to those, the Holy Spirit, who ask Him for it?" The only reason why you and I don't have from God today is because we haven't asked for it. Amen? Father, I thank You for Your Word today as we stand together. I thank You for the power of Your Word and what it tells us, what it can do today in our lives. And Father, I just ask You today that Your Word would be real and alive in our lives today. God, may Your Word accomplish here today what You are sending it forth to do. Lord, may Your Word have great power and authority in us here today. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.